Penguin Random House Audio presents Up With the Sun by Thomas Mallon. Read for you by Lowell Byers. For Lynn Freed and Patricia Hample. Author's Note. Up With the Sun is a fictionalized rendering of Dick Kallman's life and death. It is inspired by actual events that have been considerably altered by the author's imagination. Some of this novel's characters never existed at all, and those that may have some basis in actual people are not meant to be factual depictions of those persons. The book's dialogue has been created, not reiterated. Prologue, February 23, 1980. In one way, this whole story starts 30 years back, but in another, it begins 2 weeks ago, on February 7th at the Martin Beck. The first thing I remember from that night at the theater is the two fur coats, identical, huge, floor length. I watched them coming down the aisle toward the pit where I, the show's only musician, was still at the piano fussing with my sheet music a minute after the lights had come up for intermission. Those coats seemed to be moving toward me on their own. So all-enveloping, I couldn't see anybody underneath, let alone guess who was wearing them. He spoke first. "So how much are we going to lose on this bomb?" As if I were somehow in a position to know. She didn't say anything right away, but I actually recognized her before I did him. Dolores Gray. And what little of her was on view looked great. 55, maybe, striking makeup, full lips. There was enough noise in the theater, mostly people smacking their foreheads and groaning about how bad this thing was, a musical version of Harold and Maude, that I was able softly to play a couple of bars of Here's That Rainy Day, her signature number from Carnival in Flanders, a show that inexplicably flopped about 25 years ago. Dolores Gray and Dick Kallman, who I now realized was the guy wearing the other coat, turned out to be great pals, both of them with a little money in the show. "Dolores," he said, "this is Matt Leonetta." My name is actually Leonetto, but this wasn't a camp joke. Over the years, Dick had often misremembered it, willfully, I thought, as if having retained it would diminish his status. "Pleased to meet you," said Miss Gray, throaty and a bit grand. I wondered why her career had petered out so early. Married a rich guy, I think. But it was Dick I had trouble taking my eyes off. I don't think I'd seen him in 5 years, and most of the memories I had of him went back closer to 20 or 30, to his first big stage role, his nightclub gigs, and his early attempts at trying his luck in Hollywood. He had been, back then, what my daughter would now call preppy. But standing there in the Martin Beck 2 weeks ago, I couldn't get over him. I know it's the 70s. No, wait, it's already the 80s. But his getup was really out there. All I could see beneath the coat was a gold chain descending into an open mauve shirt. "You won't believe this," he said to Dolores. "But Matt was the pianist for 17. "No," she said, with just the right degree of politeness and disbelief. "You know, almost 30 years ago, surely you were too young." "Yep, he was," said Dick, all false flattery, one of his habitual modes. Now, as in the past, the phoniness coming from him could seem more charming, more authentic than sincerity would have been. I'd actually never seen Dick be truly sincere about anything. And if he'd started now, I think it would have repulsed me. As it was, He just nodded and smiled his big, overly expressive smile, as if he were acting in a silent picture. I was too young, I told Dolores. Only 19. 3 weeks into the show, they replaced me with an older guy. So that's how you met Richard? She asked. Richard? La-di-da. But she clearly knew Dick's resume, whose first big item back in 1951 was a Theater World Award as Most Promising Newcomer. He'd played Joe Bullitt, a supporting role in that musical adaptation of what the Playbill always called Booth Tarkington's timeless classic. I was up at the Mark Hellinger that summer, said Dolores, with Bert Lahr. Two on the Isle, I said. I saw it. A couple of times, in fact. Maybe even once with him, I added, pointing to Dick. And wasn't she amazing? He asked. I didn't know whether to fill her in on my other sporadic encounters with Dick, how I'd sometimes played for him in clubs, out of town, when we were still in our 20s, how I'd been asked from time to time to come around while he was doing great, like when he was back in New York on a break from touring the Bobby Morse part in How to Succeed. That was just before his brief pinnacle. The year he had the honest-to-God lead in a network sitcom called Hank. It was on Fridays, one of the nights I got to have my daughter, and we'd watch the TV together and laugh. She was only 5, but she understood this silly premise that put Dick into all the funny disguises. No, I decided not to tell Dolores about my intermittent friendship with Dick, because if I started, within a minute we'd be getting into his disappointing last decade, when his arc dipped and he was off TV except for the odd guest shot, was back to touring in other stars' musicals, and was finally doing crappy two-handers that never made it to New York. All this before he disappeared from show business altogether. We're partners, he exclaimed, draping his mink arm over Dolores' mink shoulders. Isn't that grand? For a second, I thought he meant partners in some awful Judy Garland and queer husband number 4 kind of way. But it turned out he meant partners in an antiques business. Which confused me, since post-showbiz Dick had already gone into menswear and, at least for a while, as I understood things, made a lot of money at it. He was soon explaining the way he and Dolores operated, selling everything out of an apartment, which at that moment, I didn't grasp meant his apartment. As it was, I had to keep looking around, a little nervously. Unless the stage manager knew this was Dolores Gray I was talking to, he'd want me to be out of the pit this far into intermission. A little leather datebook came out of Dick's fur pocket. From it, he extracted a business card. Possessions of Prominence, LTD. I handed it over to Detective Volker a little while ago. Leaning down, Dick stuffed it into the pocket of my opening night tuxedo and invited me to a little party on the 21st at his place in the East 70s. My hesitation must have shown, because Dolores seemed to notice and overrule it. Say yes, sweetie, let him cook for you. Besides, from the looks of this turkey, she cocked her glossy head in the direction of the stage, you're going to be out of a job by then. And I am. Harold and Maude lasted 4 performances, 2 fewer than Carnival in Flanders. But I'm out of a job more than half the time, and it's not much to worry about. A few more private lessons for Brearley girls and some extra days as the auditions pianist across the river at Paper Mill, and I'm fine until some other show comes along. In fact, subbing always suits me best. Favorite career experience? Filling in at Mac and Mabel. Best failed show ever, over Thanksgiving weekend in 74. I live at Manhattan Plaza, which, if you don't know New York, is a big, clean, high-rise nirvana of subsidized housing for music and theater people near the western edge of 42nd Street. The whole thing is spacious and kind of grand because it was built as a luxury rental before the developer went belly up 5 years ago with the rest of New York, and the state got the bright, beneficent idea to snap it up. There's a waiting list to get in here that's longer than the one for Eden.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.